Hello, Lakers Nation. Sean Davis here for LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. It's second round time. The Lakers, after starting off 2-10, being the seventh seed, the underdogs against the Memphis Grizzlies, they beat the Grizzlies in six, and now the matchup is set. Warriors, Lakers, second round. So that's not enough of a – it's too big to discuss for just myself. So we brought on the entire – not the entire, but a lot of the Lakers Nation staff. We have our editor extraordinaire, Daniel Starkand, Ron Gutterman, and Corey Hansford joining me. What's up, guys? How we feeling?
Doing good. You're doing a nice little Trevor impression to start this off here. I feel like, like the little Spider-Man looking up at the big one. So in case anyone did know, Trevor's a little under the weather today. That's why we're all here filling in.
Yeah. Corey, how we doing, bro?
I'm excited. You know, we talked about who we wanted to see in the second round. This was my choice. I may come to regret that choice, but I'm still confident right now. So for the time being, I can remain confident.
Awesome. What about you, Ron?
As good as I'm doing, Adam Silver's doing way better because he he pressed the Lakers Warriors button when that first round bracket came out, and he got what he wanted. So this is kind of the dream marquee matchup for them. I can't believe that the most interesting second round matchup is a 7 versus a 6, but here we are.
Yeah. Before we dive into all that,
we got three marquee matchups in the second round this year. Heat, Knicks, you can throw back.
Sure.
Sixers, Celtics has a lot of history. So,
and man, then somewhere out there, the 8-seeded Heat are going to just go to the finals. So, you know,
you can't forget Ron's Nuggets either.
Wow. Nuggets Homer me, apparently, is what I've come to find out on Twitter.
Nuggets and Nuggets winning it all, Ron? You can't say that, surely. Not here.
No, I have Nuggets in the finals. I've had Nuggets in the finals since the preseason. I'm sticking to it. So, you know, I'm not gonna back off my take.
I will say I saw Ron at game 4 Lakers Grizzlies, and he was wearing a Lakers jersey. So we could just clear that up. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I do still root for the Lakers primarily.
Primarily. All right. Before we get into everything, quick reminder, please do subscribe right here to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Ring that post notification bell as well. It's a great way to stay up to date with our latest content and coverage. I know personally I have like 2 more videos planned to come out, hopefully before the start of game 1 throughout, and a ton of more content from a bunch of us over at Lakers Nation. So stay up to date with our latest content. Let's start off with this series. I mean, I guess we could kind of start off like maybe the biggest X factor, because there's just too much to break down with this series. So whether it's a certain player, a matchup, something that either team might try to do, what is the biggest X factor for you guys heading into this second round matchup? Let's start off with Daniel. Daniel, what's your biggest X factor?
I think I'll go with probably the most obvious one. I think it's Anthony Davis. We saw, you know, in this last series, Looney had a really good round for the Warriors. But I think AD and the Lakers present a much different challenge for him and the Warriors front line, which outside of him, you know, you got undersized Draymond and not a whole lot of size off the bench. So if AD could really come out and be the aggressive AD that we get, you know, probably on a game-to-game basis, if he could do that consistently, maybe get Looney in foul trouble so the Warriors need to go small, and that way the Lakers could, you know, really attack them in the paint. I think that's going to be the key to this series.
Ron?
Yeah, I think that's kind of the – you're right. That's kind of the obvious one. A little bit of an underrated one that I've been thinking about is what is Jared Vanderbilt's role in this series? Is he a guy that you just stick on Andrew Wiggins? If you do that, you kind of – take away what he does best, which is kind of like, you know, taking away primary ball handlers and making them, you know, forcing them into bad decisions, forcing them into kind of dribbling out the shot clock, what he did against John Morant so well. But do you put him on Steph Curry? Because that presents a much different battle than what Jared Vanderbilt was dealing with against John Morant. Or is this not really much of a Jared Vanderbilt series, and we see a lot more Dennis Schroeder, which I think is perfectly in the realm of possibility. I think what happens with his minutes is something I'm definitely going to be watching throughout the series. I think it's a fascinating thing that's probably on the more under, like, under the radar side, you know, as opposed to like the AD Draymond Looney matchup or who guards LeBron or what they do there.
What about you, Corey?
Kind of to piggybacking off what Ron said, I think kind of the benches of both teams and each coach kind of finding that rotation that they could work with, because both the Lakers and the Warriors had issues kind of figuring out, okay, is this guy going to play? What are we going to get for the Lakers? Obviously, we've gotten basically nothing from Malik Beasley or Troy Brown in the series. In the first round series. And the Warriors were Jordan Poole up and down. They throw Moses Moody out there, Kuminga, different guys, just kind of seeing where they're going to, what they're going to get from each of their different role players. So to me, kind of seeing which of those kind of underused role players steps up to me might make the difference in the series.
I'm going to agree with Daniel, but for a different reason. I'm going to go AD, but because my entire defensive game plan for this series, go figure, revolves around Anthony Davis being able to blow up certain stuff. AD, I expect to get bare minimum 20 and like 12, hopefully more than 20 and 12, to be quite honest. But for me personally, with the game plan I put together, I need AD to be game six AD, which in my opinion, top five greatest defensive performance I've ever seen. So high standard, but AD for the defense and how I want to use them. All right. So the biggest question that I see a lot floating around on Lakers Twitter or just social media in general is Steph Curry, who has been phenomenal this postseason run. If he was healthy, maybe has a hat in the MVP argument of Golden State's better season. Who knows? But how do you guard Steph? And more importantly, who do you match up with Steph Curry? We could go to Corey first on this one.
How do you guard Steph Curry? You pray. That's number one. A whole lot. That's starting and ending point. I don't know. We've been asking this question for about a decade now, and we haven't figured it out because he's somehow gotten better. It used to be you could be physical with him. You can't do that anymore. He's a lot stronger. He can take the bumps. He's better at finishing at the rim now while still being the greatest shooter we've ever seen in the history of this game. I think you have to at least start Vanderbilt on him because, as you pointed out earlier, that's kind of his role. Like, if he's not going to do that, then it becomes a question of basically, is he going to be playable in the series? So you at least have to at least start with that. And I agree that this feels like it could be more of a Dennis Schroeder series than a D'Angelo series, because I've been sitting thinking for the last 24 hours, I don't know who you put D'Angelo Russell on. It may be Clay because he hasn't been as great. That's what I'm thinking. But if you can't figure that out, or if Clay starts being back to Clay again, you might have an issue, which makes Steph even more dangerous. But to me, it's got to be those same two. You know, maybe if Malik Beasley could hit just like two threes, you could just throw him out there just to have someone who's a little quick and can go around there, get through screens. But yeah, you've got to at least give Vanderbilt the start on it.
What about you, Ron?
Yeah, I think Vanderbilt's got to be the first option. But one thing that I like about the Lakers side of this matchup is, compared to the Kings, compared to the Nuggets, compared to the Suns, if we look at the other three teams still in the West, I think the Lakers have the most amount of options to throw at Steph Curry. Obviously, nothing's going to work super well because he's Steph Curry and nothing has ever worked super well. But I think if you look at the Lakers, I think they have the highest number of options of any team really left in the playoffs, with the exception of maybe the Celtics. I think between Dennis Schroeder and Jared Vanderbilt and Austin Reeves, you have three guys that are sort of at least somewhat capable for a couple possessions in a row to slow him down. I don't know that you're ever going to see the same guy guarding Curry for more than like a handful of possessions, because he's just going to – he takes so much out of a defender, the way he moves off the ball. You know, there was a play in Game 7 that was like so ridiculous, but only Steph could really do it. He's doing his usual thing where he's running around, and then he gets the ball in the corner after running around the half court, I think two or three times, gets the ball in the corner, fakes left, drives baseline, And instead of just like going up normally, like a normal player would do, he runs pretty much with the ball to the other corner, then turns around, goes right over the top, and then puts up like an off-balance floater in the lane and drills it. I'm like, literally, what, five players in NBA history can do this? So no one's really going to be successful in guarding him, but I think between the three options of Schroeder, Vanderbilt, Reeves, you have enough for a couple possessions at a time to keep someone fresh on him at all times. And that's kind of the only way, you know, besides prayer, like Corey said, that you're really going to have a chance.
Yeah, I'm pretty much in agreement with you guys here. I think Vanderbilt is, you know, the huge key here. You know, if he's not going to be able to guard Steph Curry, then kind of like Corey said, like, what's really his role in this series? Like, you know, they're going to sag off him offensively. So if he's not able to chase Steph around like that, then I do think you do see a lot more Dennis minutes. I'd say I probably don't want Austin on Steph like as much. I know it's going to happen at some points, but I just think with his role offensively, with him being more of a primary ball handler, it takes a lot of energy to chase Steph around, you know, through those screens on the defensive end. So I think, I know Austin is capable of doing that, but I really just don't want him gassed. He's played the most minutes for the Lakers so far in the postseason. Like, he's playing, you know, 38, 40 minutes a game. And I just don't want him chasing Steph Curry around all that much. So I think Vando's going to be the key there. If he could handle it, then that's great. You know, that's size to throw on Curry. That's some length to throw on him. But if not, I do think we're going to see a lot of Dennis in this series.
Okay. This is where there's going to be disconnect, and I'm going to piss off a lot of Laker fans in the comments. So come at me in the comments or come at me on my Twitter. My mentions are open. That's all I do on Twitter nowadays is piss people off. I'm doing Reeves on Steph. And I'm actually in agreement with Corey. He kind of mentioned it with D'Lo on Clay. Hear me out. Steph, Vando is a lot better if you have a player that is heavy one-on-one ISO. Vando does have a ton of great screen navigation. Golden State, they don't, in terms of comparatively speaking to the rest of the NBA, they run less ball screens. But Steph, and like per synergy, right? Steph Curry is 13, there's like 13.5 maybe scoring possessions per game. So a shot attempt, foul, turnover, something of that nature on Steph Curry ball screens, right? On Steph Curry isolations, it's like two possessions a game, two scoring possessions a game. So basically my point is you're utilizing Bando for two possessions a game, maybe a little bit more, maybe it's four or whatever, right? Who knows? But, and then you're not even counting in like some of the off-ball screen stuff that they run a ton for Steph, which accounts for, I think, 14% of Steph's offense, if I recall correctly. I'll fact check that in my Steph video, but I'm going Reeves because Reeves is just better in terms of screen navigation. That's what I'm more concerned about, at least in that starting group. When you get to like some Dennis minutes and Dennis and Reeves are on the floor, or Austin and Troy are on the floor at the same time, then that's when I probably give Reeves a break and let one of those other guys who also have good screen navigation guard Steph. But again, that's just based off how I've seen on tape. And I know I'm going to piss some people off because Bando, there's some stuff going around on Bando, like a minute or so clips of Bando doing fine on Steph. Sure. Like if they decide to go ISO heavy, which just isn't how Golden State plays, then you make an adjustment in game and say, okay, here you go, Bando, go guard Steph 94 feet. But with the knowledge that that's likely not what they're going to do, I lean Reeves. But I definitely understand the concerns that Daniel brought up. But go ahead and slander me and call me an idiot for that take.
Well, yeah, let me just be clear. I do think Reeves is probably the best option. I just don't want him dead on the offensive end where his role is just as important, if not more important in this series. But I definitely think if you're for all the reasons you kind of just mapped out, like I don't think Vando is the perfect option for Steph. Like he's not really known to chase around screens like that, and I do think Reeves is capable of doing that. But I just think just to conserve Reeves' energy more, I think that's going to have to be Vando. If not, then Vando's going to be, you know, on the bench for most of the series, like some of you guys have said. So I do think Reeves, like, you know, in a perfect world, he's able to take on that matchup. I just don't know if he can. We'll see. I think he'll get the task at points, and we'll see how it goes.
Yeah, I wonder if we end up with like a lineup combination of Dennis, Austin Reeves, and Rui Hachimura, with Rui Hachimura guarding Andrew Wiggins, Reeves on Clay and Dennis on Steph, preserve Reeves's energy by kind of Clay's not running around the same way he used to. He has never dribbled basketballs routinely during games. That's never been his thing. So Austin Reeves can kind of just like be stand up defender, not have to do too much. Just keep him off his spots, which is obviously more easier said than done, but still. You have Rui for Wiggins, which that's kind of like Wiggins' style of offense matches into what Rui does well defensively, which is sort of keeping a man in front, kind of forcing him into those like one dribble pull up type things, not really letting him do too much off the ball. I think that's what Rui does best there. And then Dennis is kind of your chase Steph around guy, which, yeah, it'll probably take him out of the game offensively because he will just be too gassed to do anything. But if you're asking me, who do I prefer to be, sort of tired on the offensive end, Dennis or Reeves, I'm preferring Dennis because I want Reeves at his best. That's kind of the lineup combination I see coming up more frequently, just because D'Lo and Vando, if they're not really at their best on their good end of the floor, D'Lo offensively, Vando defensively, it becomes hard to see how they play a role in this series, like in a 35-minute-a-night capacity.
And then the other thing that concerns me with Reeves potentially guarding Steph is just there's a lot of opportunity to pick up bad cheap fouls. Going around a bunch of screens, having to cut back and forth, oh, he beat me, grabs, all those little things, run into a screen, it might go one way or the other way, goes on Reeves. Like that, all those things can just – Reeves picking up two quick cheap fouls in the first 4 minutes is not something that I want to see, because then you're looking at extended minutes for guys who have been up and down to be kind so far in these playoffs. And I don't want – none of us want some 7 or 8 minute stretch of Troy Brown or Malik Beasley. We don't want this right now. And Reeves being in foul trouble – makes that much more of a likely possibility, and that no, just please no.
Real quick, I do think Troy Brown, like on the defensive end, would be like someone you could use this series. He's shown in the regular season, in the Lakers Warriors games, that he can chase around Steph. He does have some length, but if he shot the way he shot in the last series, I don't know if he'll be playable. I think he'll get a chance in the early games of the series just for his defense. And we'll see if he can, at least knock down a few shots to be at least, respectable on that end.
It's interesting, by the way. I just want to point out, we did this whole conversation about, the defensive game plan and not one mention of Jordan Poole, which that should tell you everything you need to know about how Jordan Poole played in round one.
He'll still have one game where he drops 30 for sure.
He'll have one game, but man, Jordan Poole got to be one of the most frustrating players I've ever watched. But it's just wanted to point that out. We had like a 8-minute discussion and literally his name was not mentioned even one time.
So one of my questions, this question to you guys, because I'm curious what you guys feel. How much stock do you all put in the fact that the Lakers did win the regular season series 3-1? Do you put any stock into it at all, or is it just maybe more process-based things or nothing at all?
Nothing at all for me. I think two of those games were without Steph. I think one of those games was with Russell Westbrook.
LeBron didn't play for
two. One was without one, because that's LeBron the picture. Of AD yelling in Draymond's face and Bron like being the hype man in the cool street clothes. I love
that. That was the last game when Steph played. It was literally the game Steph came back from his extended absence.
That's right.
He still kind of went off though, but yeah,
he definitely.
I don't think honestly, and I said this. I recorded with Trevor right before the playoffs started, and I said just in general, like in any matchup, forget the Lakers specifically. Regular season matchups mean pretty much nothing to me at this point. Just because in almost every regular season series, you can look at least two or three of the games where this star was missing. This star didn't play really at all. This person did this, or this team made this trade. Regular season matchups mean less and less. And I feel like this is just a whole new ballgame. And that's what makes it so exciting, because it's like these two teams really are kind of at full strength now, at their best. They look great. Steph is like otherworldly Steph right now. I think it's going to be a super fun series for that reason.
And just to add on to that, and Sean could speak to this more, but in the regular season, there's not a whole lot of game planning that goes on. Like, yeah, you know, you got 24 hours to prepare for your next opponent or whatever, and then you're on to the next one. Like, in a series, in a seven-game series, there's going to be adjustments. There's going to be adjustments to the adjustments. You're going to adjust to what they're doing. So things are going to change from game to game, and everyone's just a lot more locked in compared to the regular season.
And not to mention, if we're really wanting to think about regular season, how many road wins did the Warriors have in the regular season?
11.
They got two. And they just got 20% basically of their road wins in their first playoff series.
They were awful on the road. It's also this is kind of, I don't know if this is like being too much of like an overreaction or like too much of like a hot take. I don't know what it is. I'm considering game one kind of a must win. I know it's on the road. I know it's in Golden State. Like, I get that. But the Lakers have had 6 days where, like, okay, they can say that they were game planning for both the Kings and Warriors, but I think like everyone was kind of in agreement that the Warriors were probably going to win that series. Like, that was just kind of the talk. So I'm sure that was the talk within the team too. They've had like 6 days, 5 days to game plan for this, and the Warriors had to play a game seven less than 48 hours ago at the time of the game. They will have played like 48 hours ago. So the Warriors have not had any time really to game plan for the Lakers specifically because they were too worried about the Kings. And the Lakers have had the whole weekend pretty much to just sit there and plan for the Warriors. And yeah, maybe they were also planning for the Kings, but they had time to sit and plan for the Warriors. So the Lakers have to come out as the more prepared team. And of course, a Steph 50 ball can ruin any game plan, but like, you're the more prepared team. You're the more rested team. I think you have to come out and make a statement and steal one in Golden State. It feels like so necessary because if you go down 1-0 and now the Warriors have time to review film and game plan and do all this specifically for you, it feels like you're flirting with trouble there.
So Ron already.
I also, sorry, just real quick, just to add on to that, I think once the series starts, it's a game every other day for the entire series. So this game one is the most rested the Lakers will be.
Yeah. Well, you guys already answered my next question, but to respond to the initial question, I agree from the standpoint that the regular season wins don't mean anything. I think there's some things, so from a process standpoint, that you can look at and say, okay, this worked well. We can try to use this. Like, for example, Golden State really had, I get it, personnel matters, but Golden State really struggled at guarding some of the Lakers' favorite stuff from their playbook, especially for Anthony Davis. And then some of the things that I want the Lakers to do, which will be in an article on the LakersNation.com website, the live film breakdown, and a video I'm doing on Steph, probably coming out tomorrow. They've done those things. So there's reason for optimism. And when you are game plan, you can say, okay, what things do we do? And okay, well, hey, we've done this already. Maybe you refine it. You have some more preparation, like Ron said, like Daniel said. It's going to be a more loaded scouting report, sure. But from a process standpoint, from the stuff I want them to do, they've already done it and they've done it pretty well. So that stuff I've taken away. The wins, honestly, mean nothing. Like if they had won one game, but the process still there, I would have been happy still. But yeah, I do agree that the wins necessarily don't really matter at all. So I don't know.
Well, so then let me ask you this, Sean, from a coaching perspective. I was just curious how Darvin Ham's lack of experience, how that will be matching up with Steve Kerr in a postseason scenario.
So hot take, I guess I'm known for him at this point. I'm going to, again, piss people off. From a game plan standpoint, the coaching staff has my trust. From a game plan standpoint, post trade deadline, I liked it a lot. And then that first round series against Memphis, they kind of won me over consistently from a game plan standpoint. The rotations are still a problem. The timeout usage is still a problem. I think that's where you could see the biggest mismatch in terms of coaching with Kerr and Darvin. But the chess match, I will say, you kind of alluded to this, Daniel, the chess match throughout the series is going to be really, really fun to watch. So keep an eye out for that. But Yeah. Go ahead, Ron.
I think Steve Kerr is probably a better coach than Darvin Ham, I think it's fair to say.
Yeah.
But also, Steve Kerr is just, like, so in tune with his guys that, like, Darvin Ham, he did have a great first-round series. I thought he planned extremely well for Memphis. I thought the game-to-game adjustments were really solid. You know, John Morant obviously, like, hurting his hand kind of helped the Lakers. But I felt like outside of that one explosion in game three, I think it was, when the Lakers were pretty much ahead the whole game, I thought the Lakers did a pretty good job with John Morant. Their game plan with him was really solid. But I think, like, you're never going to be able to replicate the amount of experience Steve Kerr has with his guys. And so with Darvin Ham, like, with game planning, you just kind of have to, like, do the best you can to figure out how to stop, you know, the Warriors at their absolute best. But Steve Kerr is going to have the ace of, I've been working with this core for 8-9 years now, and I'm just going to have that over you at all times.
Really quick, because I know there's going to be some aggregation or misunderstanding what I was saying there. Steve Kerr is absolutely a better coach than Darvin Ham. Please.
I wanted to get you on the record with that, too.
Yes, it is the record. And also, to put it on the record, I think Darvin is average, to be completely honest. I think he's average. Like, I don't think he's great. I just don't think he's the worst coach ever, which I get told every day. So that's my standpoint there. But last question before we kind of get into our final series predictions and picks for the series. Is there anything that we haven't necessarily covered yet that is a massive concern for, maybe not a massive concern, but something to keep an eye out for heading into this series?
I mean, something we haven't really touched on. We touched on how the Lakers are going to match up with the Warriors, but, you know, what about the opposite? Like, if you look at the Lakers starting five, there's, outside of Jared Vanderbilt, like, there's four real offensive threats in there, which means, you know, Steph and Clay are probably going to be guarding D'Lo and Reeves. So how do you make, you know, those guys work on that? And so maybe they're a little more tired on the offensive end, you know?
Yeah, I think what helps the Warriors defensively is that the Lakers don't necessarily play with pace. I don't know if we've they're a little bit slow. D'Lo is not the type, and look, I think D'Lo is great. I think he obviously was good in that game six, was fantastic in that game six. He's not necessarily the type of offensive player I think is going to, like, tire out a defender. He might, like, wear you down mentally by just hitting shot after shot, but he's not really a kind of guy that's going to, like, tire you out defensively. Reeves might do that. He might, like, physically wear you down by just, like, unrelenting attack, and I think Dennis Schroeder is the same way. But I think what's really interesting to me is how Kevon Looney and Draymond Green are used. I think you know, you're going to see a lot of both of them on AD. And if Jared Vanderbilt's in the game, the other one of Looney and Draymond is pretty much going to be a free safety defensively. And they're going to go wherever they want. It's probably going to be Draymond who does that with Looney on AD. That feels like how it's going to start. And that's why we talked about Vanderbilt. Like, if he's not elite defensively right away, I don't know how this is a Jared Vanderbilt series. I could see him on the bench very quickly, because if Draymond Green is allowed to be a free safety and AD isn't completely dominating Kevon Looney, it could get pretty ugly, because Draymond Green, if he's free to do whatever, he's going to wreck pretty much anything. That's just how he is defensively. It's how he's been forever. So that's why it's so important that Jared Vanderbilt is good. And that's really what I'm watching for.
Got that out. Corey?
We definitely have not touched on the glass and the rebounding and the fact that Memphis, despite being down two of their best rebounders and the best offensive rebounder in the league, well, actually, Kevon Looney might argue that point now, but one of the best offensive rebounders in the league, and they still killed the Lakers on the, even in losses, they were still getting multiple chances. And what completely took the sails out of the Kings in Game 7 was Kevon Looney single-handedly getting offensive rebound after offensive rebound after offensive rebound. If that's still an issue for the Lakers in clearing the glass, it doesn't matter how good defense you play. If Looney's still moving people out of the way and getting those offensive rebounds, the last thing, and it's probably the most disheartening thing in basketball, definitely over this last 25 years probably, is a Warriors miss. You breathe a sigh of relief. Looney gets an offensive rebound, and they kick it out to Steph. And you can just look away at that point because you know the outcome of it. And you cannot. It will take the absolute sails out of the entire building. We heard that yesterday in Game 7. So ensuring that everybody is crashing the glass and they are putting bodies on Looney. Obviously, Davis is not Sabonis. He's not just going to get moved out of the way Sabonis did that entire series. But if we have, we're probably due two of those iffy AD not completely locked in games that we saw. And you can't afford to give away games like that to a team like the Warriors that just feeds off this. They've been here. Nothing is going to be afraid of them. You can't let up. Oh, we have this lead. We're at home now. They don't care. Go look back how many times the Warriors went on the road in a bad situation, a must-win situation, and dominate. There's nothing that's going to be afraid of them. So, but to me, definitely making sure they are cleaning the glass and not giving Golden State those extra opportunities, because those are the ones that have just completely demoralized the team.
Yeah.
And even a guy like Wiggins, sorry, just to add to that real quick, a guy like Wiggins crashes the glass offensively too. So if LeBron's on him, or if Vando, whoever's on him, you got to make sure he boxes out, because, you know, with high volume 3-point shooting, there's going to be a lot of long rebounds. And like Corey said, that's a very easy way to get demoralized against this team for sure.
Yeah. And to Ron's point about Vando, that's been really frustrating to watch offensively, them not really figure out how to utilize Vando, which is kind of easy. Just pair him with the shooter. Like the problem with Malik Beasley, and I'm not advocating for Malik Beasley minutes. Trust me, I'm not. But I'm not, I promise you. But if you had paired
John's
Vando
got some
with
wild pull quotes in this episode.
if you like paired Vando and Beasley together, you could, if you utilize them properly, you could kill two birds with one stone. Utilize Vando as a screener for Beasley. So one, you kind of attack how teams are going to guard Vando, not guarding him. And two, you get Beasley open looks off of off screens where he's like a 45% 3-point shooter off of off screens as a Laker, where it's like 30%, maybe 32% on spot up look. So I'm not advocating for Beasley minutes, but I'm just saying the fact that it's frustrating that they haven't figured out how to properly use Vando offensively to where he might not be able to play, especially if you aren't sold on him guarding Steph. I'm definitely not sold on him guarding Clay. All right.
Or you could sprinkle some of that Steph Curry prayer on Jared Vanderbilt at two corner threes every game, like you did that in game four. Against
there you go.
Yeah, there we go.
Real quick, if Beasley continues this awful slide, do we toss out Lonnie Walker for a couple minutes to see if he has something?
Corey, you look like every mention of all of our tweets ever.
No, because I didn't mention Mo Bamba. So,
yeah, sure. Or wait, where's Tristan Thompson? Forgot about
that. Yeah, let me just get out ahead of that. This is not a Mo Bamba series. Let me just We should not be expecting to see Mo Bamba in this series.
You mean the high-paced Warriors with three of like the 10 best shooters in the league is not a series for our slow 7-foot backup center?
Yeah. Yeah,
that's also exciting. Not a physical presence in the paint and would rather hang around the 3-point line.
Fascinating.
Shocker. All right. Final thing before we get out of here. We're going to make our picks. We can go Corey, Dan, then Ron, and then I'll round it out. Corey, what's your final pre-series pick heading into this one?
I asked for this, and hopefully I don't end up like Dylan Brooks by the end of this series. Steph scared the crap out of me before he dropped 50 in the most important game on the road in a hostile environment. And he scares me even more. Steve Kerr versus Darvin Ham matchup scares the crap out of me. And all that being said, I feel like this is the matchup that the Lakers need in order for like LeBron and AD. Like, this is the kind of thing where AD knows, oh, I'm going up against Draymond. I can't let up because Draymond's here, because Steph's here. I think where you can, other matchups, you can kind of coast a little bit. Nah, I'm not sure if they're going to. He knows this is the championship Warriors. And if we're getting odd game odd number game AD for a full series. That's the difference maker. Lakers in six.
Okay.
Daniel?
Let me just go on record as saying that I was on the opposite end of Corey. I thought the Kings were a much easier matchup here. So I am a little terrified here just for all the reasons he laid out. You know, Steph Curry, Clay could get hot at any time. Jordan Poole, like I said, probably got one 30-point game in him there somewhere, even if he's been really bad. With all that said, though, I do think there are, you know, matchups for the Lakers to exploit here. I do think they're a much more physical team, and I think it's going to be a much different series than what we just saw with Memphis. Like, that was two very physical teams. I think this is going to be a very different brand of basketball, and if the Lakers could exploit those matchups inside, if they could get, you know, Looney and Draymond in foul trouble, I think they can have a lot of success. I do think the advantage is for the Lakers in game one because they're going to have a lot of rest, so I'm gonna end up agreeing with Corey, although for different reasons, but I'm gonna say Lakers in six. I think the Lakers home court advantage is a real thing. We've seen so far in this postseason, they haven't lost at home, and Ron can attest, like, the crowds have been insane at those games. So I think that's a factor too. So I'll say Lakers in six.
Oh man. See, here's the thing. I don't want to just say the same thing as everybody else. I want to be different, of course.
Ron's going to pull something out and say Warriors in five. And just immediately.
Nuggets in four.
Nuggets in four. I think Lakers in six is like a fair prediction. I'm just going to stick with what I put originally, which now that I'm looking at it, I don't know why I put this originally. I don't have a thought process behind it. I had Lakers in seven, and I think that's just because I trust LeBron in game sevens above all else, which is ridiculous when Steph Curry literally just had the most points in a game seven in NBA history. Mm-hmm. But that's what I'm sticking with. I think these are two really evenly matched teams. They do different things very well. And I think both teams can look at this series and be like, oh, we have mismatches we can exploit here. And so I think that's the makings of a great playoff series, is what buttons are pushed at the right time. And I think the button that matters above all else is I'm LeBron James button that he can press at any time. And so I think if it came down to it in a game seven, I would trust LeBron over the home Warriors. So I'm going
Lakers in
right
seven.
Before the prediction.
Lakers in
gotcha.
Did I get lost? Did I get lost?
You said my prediction is, and then it froze.
amazing timing. That's great. My prediction is Lakers in seven.
There you go.
Your connection tried to stop you from saying something tragic like Warriors in seven or anything Warriors related. It was saving you from yourself there, Ron.
But I thought you were going to go Lakers in five. I was really ready for you to just go full Lakers in five. I was
full turn talking all this about how evenly matched it is. I'm like, and that's why Lakers in a sweep.
Lakers in five. I'm going to preface this by saying, in agreement with Ron, it's going to be a great series. It's going to be really, really fun. Probably the best second round series, in my opinion. I'm also going to preface this with, I feel as good as you can feel about facing Steph Curry's 7-game playoff series. I think the Lakers have the best shot at, in air quotes, slowing down Steph Curry. I'm going Lakers in six. I think they match up well with Golden State. Already done some things that I'll go into more detail over the next 24 hours or whatever that I think and I hope they will continue to do. Obviously, you have the chess with Steve Kerr and Darvin Ham. Darvin, don't lose it by a ton. We'll be fine. Just, like, don't get shredded and we'll be okay. But you have the LeBron James element, like Ron said. AD being AD, if he could do that consistently, maybe instead of having two terrible games, let's have one bad game. Just cut it down to one, you know, make sure the one is in a loss or actually hopefully in a win. He play like AD the rest of the way. But all seriousness, the data in the film that I've seen, it looks really encouraging. Steph Curry factor is real. So he's having an unreal run, but Lakers in six. I feel as good as you can feel right now. But
all yeah, right. So surely this will not backfire on all of us, right?
Absolutely.
But above all else, guys, it's still Nuggets in five. Above all.
Oh, there you go. All right.
Above all
else. It comes down to it.
Goes without saying.
Let's make sure we don't bring Ron on for a Lakers Nuggets series. Let's make sure that definitely
happens. I'm gonna be honest, in my pre-playoff prediction, I had Nuggets Lakers in the conference finals, and I said Nuggets in five. So like it's
five. Wow.
So five. Don't, wow.
I can explain why if you let me on the preview show for that series.
No. I don't know we'll about see. That one. I could. We'll see.
No.
But thank you guys so much. Thanks, Ron. Thanks, Daniel. Thanks, Corey, for hopping on here. It was a ton of fun talking Lakers for 40 minutes or whatever. Subscribe right here to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Ring that post notification bell for more. Go over to Apple Podcasts, Spotify, wherever you listen to your podcast. Subscribe to the Lakers Nation podcast. Give us a 5-star rating and review. Great way to help out the show. Till next time, stay safe and see ya.